हेलो, हाय। हेलो एवरीवन। ओके, सो इट्स अ ग्रेट संडे मॉर्निंग एंड वी डिसाइडेड टू हैव अ लाइव सेशन कंडक्टेड इन द फर्स्ट हाफ ऑफ द डे। दिस इज द फर्स्ट लाइव सेशन ऑफ दैट काइंड। वी विल बी जॉइंड बाय अक्षय इन अ फ्यू मिनट्स एंड it's going to be an amazing session. That's what I can guarantee. So,
Hi.
Hey, how are you? Just give me a minute.
Yeah.
I want to connect with my earphones. Just a minute.
Sure.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, you're very
Yeah.
nicely audible.
Okay.
By the way, good morning, and have
Yes.
a like it's a good Sunday basically, so we're
It
going to
is
be having an
definitely.
amazing session. Yeah, so Akshay, I've been looking forward to have a chat with you for my audiences from really really long, and I also approached you a couple of times, but things didn't just
Yeah,
happen.
they didn't
So
click, yeah.
yeah. So how are you? How are you keeping up, and how is 2020 treating you?
I mean, 2020 is different. Definitely, I did not expect it to be like this. But when life gives you lemons, I think this is actually a good learning experience for every one of us because nobody could have predicted something like this. So it's a good learning experience. I'm going to keep that. I'm going to keep whenever this things gets over and we go back to normal. This will serve as a reminder to us that even when the times were tough, we made it through. So that's actually a good thing.
Absolutely. So Akshay, a lot of people have been waiting to hear from you regarding resources and courses and projects and portfolio and so on and so forth. We will be getting started with it, but before that, I just want to give everyone a quick introduction as to who you are. So, Akshay Bahadur is working as a software development engineer in Semantic Software India, and he's also a Google Developer Expert for machine learning. He's quite a celebrity upon LinkedIn and also on other platforms, I'm very sure. And a lot of people do look up to him, especially his projects in computer vision. I mean, he also has his own website wherein he has listed all of those. You can go check them up. You can also reach out to him if you've got any doubts. He is super friendly and loves to interact with people and the community. He's also been a speaker at a couple of good conferences as well as meetups. So he's deeply rooted in the community, and he's just a very interesting person. So welcome, Akshay.
Thank you so much. I actually don't believe in all of that, but yeah, I'm going to take it with a pinch of salt.
Thank you so much. So Akshay, I want to ask you, how did your journey begin? Like, how did your machine learning data science journey begin, and where did it all start, and what pushed you to pursue this field?
I think it is. I mean, so when I started. I mean, machine learning, I was, I think, in the first year of my work. I was working as a Java developer in a telecom-based company. Although I loved that job, I am still friends with all my colleagues from that job. I absolutely loved it. But I felt that I could, I would want to explore more things. That's when I came across machine learning, which was a perfect amalgamation between mathematics and computer science. That's when I started learning, and slowly things started falling into place. I did a lot of open source work for myself, just for my learning, and people started liking my work, and that motivated me. So I think that was more of how I started with machine learning.
So, what were a few resources that you referred, like while studying about it, while getting to know more about it?
So the one of the problems, not exactly a problem I'll say, but a challenge is because this field is new and a lot of people are interested in this field, you have a lot of resources. So when I started, it was difficult because I was looking at of course Google and all finding these resources, but there were n number of resources. So I just went ahead with with just anything. So I started with some courses on YouTube, or maybe just getting started on YouTube. So I saw a couple of videos by Siraj Rawal that interested me. Although I will say that it is not exactly as it is advertised. Nobody can learn machine learning in 5 minutes. That got me interested. I'll definitely agree with that. And then I took up some courses online. But then most of the work that I believe is, most of the learning can only happen once you have that sort of motivation from within yourself. So that's all I say to that.
Yeah, interesting. Were there a couple of books or courses you referred to?
Yeah, so I will definitely recommend a few courses. One is by Coursera, by professor called Andrew Ng or Andrew Ng. He has a very good course in machine learning. It's a bit old, I'll say, because it's in MATLAB. I think it was published in 2009 or something. But all the concepts are still very valuable. So if anybody wants to start, that is a course that I will definitely recommend. And then after that, if you want to get into deep learning, then deep learning has there's a specialization course at Coursera called as deep learning specialization deeplearning.ai. That's also a good course. Apart from that, one of the books that I refer to is Deep Learning by Ian Goodfellow.
It's amazing.
PDFs online. Yeah, that's a very interesting book. And then you also have a couple of books on by O'Reilly. I think O'Reilly and Giron has hands-on deep learning and cyclone. That's, I think, very interesting. And then you also have another book called as Introduction to Deep Learning with Python. I'm actually reading that book right now. It's by Franco Porcella. He is the writer of Keras. So he has a great book on that.
Interesting. A lot of people from the community are beginners and they do refer to a lot of resources. You know, every nook and corner, you'll find articles and blogs and roadmaps and everything, all sorts of stuff. But what I really struggle with, Akshay, is practical implementation. So, if you could share a little more insights on how one can go about learning machine learning the practical way, it will be great.
I think everybody has a different mindset, I believe. So practical implementation is something that should be very, it's very subjective. But having said that, I can tell you how I started with the practical implementation. So I used to do all these courses online, okay, and they have certain tests at the end of the week. So that's actually good. You could do a lot of practicals, but later down the line, I realized that I was not able to apply these concepts on a real world problem. And that's actually that's more difficult because at work or at a company where you'll be working, you will not be expected to be given a very clean data set. So working on something for the real world is actually very different from what you get in practices or online quizzes. So that's how I started. I picked up some data sets from Kaggle.com. And we also have other repositories available online. We have one by UCI, that is University of California, Irvine. They also have a repository for machine learning. All the basic data sets like Iris data set is available. So that's how I started, because I was actually much more comfortable doing stuff. Therefore, I picked up these basic projects like hand digit recognition, alphabet recognition, and I used all the things that I've learned in the past month or so, or maybe in past courses, and I applied them to this data set, and I then published my results. So I think that was my learning process for practical implementations.
Nice. I think you've already listed a lot of resources. I will be putting them up in my Telegram channel or stories for other you know, audiences that have been following us through the life. So everybody gets access. Another question I have for you, Akshay, is that you're working as a software development engineer at Symantec Software. So what does your day look like? And, you know, are you actually working on some data science in your organization?
Right now I think that's slightly different because I'm working from home, so things look more different. But yeah, I'll tell you like a normal day how we start. So because at Symantec I work in the data platform team. Basically, we're working with data on scale, which is entirely different from what I do in my personal research. My personal research is mostly in image processing. That is fun. I really like that. But yeah, at work, what I do is also something that I really like. So that's building machine learning systems and pipelines, data analytics system on scale. So we have so I cannot go into a lot of detail, but it's the data set is entirely different because we only work with cybersecurity data. We build pipelines, clean the events and that's coming in, and we provide that to the customers. So yeah, so it's slightly boring, but I kind of enjoy it. So that's it.
Nice. Now that you've mentioned cybersecurity, can you name a few applications wherein, you know, cybersecurity and machine learning go along, or data science and machine, or cybersecurity and data science go along?
Yeah, I
Like,
think
how can you apply?
That's a great question. I think every field which uses data should at least have some, maybe if not in a very huge a very huge concept, but at least if you want to start with something, if you want to get insights, then definitely a data scientist or a machine learning engineer is the correct way to go. So let's say in cybersecurity data, let's say we have different events that comes in. Let's say these events could be, so let's say if you enter a wrong password, that's an event for us. That's a security event for us. Okay.
True.
And sometimes what happens is, or let's say to give you another easy example, let's say during the night time, we usually expect the data to be coming in at a less rate. But if the data comes
True.
in at a very high rate, that means that there's something wrong with the system. We have a check in place which checks. But sometimes the reverse can also be true because a lot of people, they kind of they take a backup of the data, and in that case, you will also have a lot of security events that coming in. So we have to have a pipeline or a model that is able to identify the actual event from the anomalous events. So that is some place that we use machine learning, and we could use machine learning for security events.
I also worked on a couple of projects in machine learning, and one of them was, you know, malicious URL detection. So that is another application. So
Definitely.
apart from that, I wanted to ask you, how do you think is the situation after COVID-19 going to be? A lot of people also say that this field is going to get saturated and there will be no jobs, freshers have no say, and only experienced professionals are favored and given preference. So how do you see it?
I think this was also said when we had the last recession, I think 2011 or something. I believe that after that recession, people had a new perspective towards things. People were more, they took into account a lot of different things that, whatever happens if there's a next recession. So people were taking these things into account. So definitely it's going to be slightly challenging. I'm not saying that it's not going to be challenging, but yeah, for freshers, it's going to be slightly challenging. But at the same time, I'll say that, this is actually a good learning experience for everyone, because now our
True.
backs are against the walls. So whatever we do is going to define us. It's going to define this generation. So I'm really hopeful that things turn out well, and hopefully you will get to interview more people who are actually been a part of the current pandemic and have turned out to be success stories.
Absolutely. Akshay, you seem to be someone who is like super into applied machine learning and you have a great project portfolio. So if you can give some tips as to, you know, how beginners can really get started, what kind of project should they pick up initially, and how to build a very good project portfolio so that, you know, they can stand out among others in the field.
Yeah, so I think first, if you are, let's say, just getting started with machine learning, there are very few of them which are very basic projects which I will recommend. That is, let's say, sentiment analysis or just maybe, logistic regression on Titanic data set or maybe alphabet recognition. So we have all these basic projects that you should do because it gives you a good starting point of, understanding how a model works. Once you have
True.
that knowledge, once you know what you're working on, then you can pick up more complicated courses, more complicated projects. Maybe these projects could be something very personal to you. You can even brainstorm with your friends. So speaking of friends, a lot of my friends are online and they are also have joined this chat. I'm very thankful to all of them. We have GV, Jipte Singh, Raghav Patnecha, and Anushwa Sahu. All of my friends are, couple of my friends are here, so they're supporting me and also posting something funny
Nice.
in the chats. I'm reading all of them. So yeah, so coming back to the question about the projects, one thing that I will definitely recommend is that everyone should a very should build something and should get something original to this field. So, for example, what I did might be useful, might not be useful, but I kind of integrated machine learning with computer vision. That was kind of my thing. That is something that I believe was slightly original, and therefore people started liking my work. So, if anybody has any ideas, and this happened because I studied a bit of computer vision back in college, and I could connect these two dots. And if somebody has studied something else, maybe they could connect those two dots and they can provide good original work. And that's going to help them build their portfolio.
So Akshay, you mentioned the computer vision projects. What are a few that you have worked on? If you had to tell our audiences a little brief about these projects so that they get to go up on your GitHub or your platform where you've hosted those and find out more about your projects.
Okay, so one of the, I think, interesting projects that I worked on is called as Emojinator. So basically what it does is that based on your hand gestures, it's going to predict the emoji that you're trying to say. And this happened way before when Instagram came up with their own hand gesture challenge. So I think this was interesting. I worked on this with a friend of mine, Raghav Patnecha. He's a brilliant software engineer. He came up with, and both of us, we came up with algorithms and we tried and tested it out, and finally one of it worked, so that's actually a good thing. Apart from that, I am recently been working on a project which is very special to me. I'm building a sign language recognition system for India, which is the Indian Sign Language. And for that project, I got to showcase that project at Google's headquarters in California. So
Amazing.
that was a big achievement for me, and that all started because I had a vision in mind. That is, this is what I want to do with the project because I felt that the deaf and mute community in India was being underrepresented. So that is something that I did. I
True.
did not intend to go to present my work at Google's headquarters, but when things started to click, and I ended up going there last year in October, and I presented my work there.
Amazing. That's amazing to know. I think I should really congratulate you. And
Thank you so much.
a lot of people are going to look forward to your work post this session.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Another question I have for you is that how can see because a lot of people do refer to research papers, but they get overwhelmed by all the math. And how much math do you think is necessary and important for someone to get started?
I will definitely recommend mathematics is important. The more you know, the better. That's what I'll say. But at the same time, we have different levels, even for machine learning. So we will have a level such as research scientist, which is going to only be working on your algorithm. So for that, you need to know a lot of mathematics. If
Correct.
you're working with, let's say, applied scientists, then you will know less mathematics, but you will have to know more of computer science. That's when people actually take these research papers and try to implement them. Then you have machine learning engineers, which should know mathematics, but at the same time they should also have a good idea about about how will you implement that in computer science and how will you handle the data aspect as well. And similarly, you have other levels. So let's say if you want to go into research part, then definitely I will recommend you guys to know mathematics so that you have an idea about calculus, algebra, probability, and statistics. I think that is important. But at the same time, if you want to get into this field, I will definitely recommend that you at least have some basic knowledge. And for the resources for mathematics, you can find, I think, all of them on Google. If you just search for math, statistics, or any of these four topics that I mentioned, Khan Academy is something that I refer to, and it's pretty good. So you guys can also do the same.
Yeah, Khan Academy is actually a very good resource.
Yeah.
Apart from that, Akshay, there must have been certain instances wherein you felt like, you know, you came across a hurdle and you really had to overcome it and, get through. So what were a few hurdles you came across while pursuing your journey, especially in machine learning and data science? And what are a few things you would recommend your audiences to avoid on?
One of the things that, talking about the hurdles, I think the first one was, getting, actually starting to explore myself. And by that, I mean, so before machine learning, I actually explored computer vision, as already mentioned. I explored a bit of IoT, a bit of blockchain, because at that time, blockchain was a big thing. I will definitely recommend everyone to, explore themselves. So even if you want to pursue machine learning, it's good to have explored your options. So that was a hurdle, not a hurdle, but I'll say a slight challenge for me, because I did not know what I wanted to get into. And talking about the actual hurdles, I think mathematics was slightly difficult for me, not slightly, but quite a lot difficult for me. So I had to go back. I had to study statistics, algebra, calculus, probability back from class 10. And that was pretty difficult for me, at least, because I was not very good at mathematics, but somehow I managed. And then, of course, the resources are n number of resources. So it's difficult for you to actually concentrate on one resource. I think having somebody as a mentor, maybe, you can look for resources on LinkedIn. I used to follow a lot of good people. I used to follow Fabio Vasquez, Gary Singh.
Yeah.
And then you also have other great personalities which keep on posting some great resources. So I went ahead with that. And then finally, there were less resources available, in terms of implementation. So implementation part was difficult. That's how I started implementing and open sourcing, because I could not find implementations. So I thought that I'll just open source my work. That's going to be a good starting point for others if they want to follow along.
I absolutely agree with you about the math part. I think I personally started my journey with neural networks. Okay. And I had no clue about machine learning, whether or not it even exists. So the first term I had heard about was neural networks, and I really wanted to explore what it looked like. And back then I was only in my first year, I guess. And I went ahead with the course, and it was a little overwhelming, with the calculus coming up and, the whole gradient thing and back propagation and differentiation and stuff like that. But eventually things did turn out well, and I found out I should have done a little bit of machine learning initially and then moved on to deep learning and stuff like that. But, that's the whole point. I never had a guide or a mentor, and that inspired me to be one for someone else a little or big way.
So coming back to the second point, I think I missed out the second point, which was, I think, somewhere along the lines of, finding good resources. What was the last question? I can't remember at this point. You had two,
What were a few things you would want, our audiences that are viewing us today to avoid in their journey? These little loopholes.
Okay, loopholes. So what I will recommend is to fall into these loopholes, because that's how you will learn. If I tell you 10 things that you should not do, and let's say you avoid all these 10 things, But what's going to happen when you actually get the 11th thing wrong? And then that you will be in a much bigger trouble because you haven't failed before. So I will just probably, tell you that you should, you should have, should work on these problems yourself. You should fall into these loopholes, then look for help. But if that happens, that's actually going to help you understand the nuances of this field. So just go out there, make your mistakes, but at the same point, learn from them. So that is, I think, the only advice that I will give in terms of, having some failures or mistakes.
True, true, true. Avoid not exploring and avoid, just not getting started. Because people worry about perfection, people worry about so many minutest details, and they just never really get started. I think that's where a lot of people tend to go wrong. Another question I have for you is that, how important do you think is being in close touch with the community, networking, interaction, presentation skills, communication skills in entirety?
I think it's really important because so all of these aspects are going to add to your to your value. So let's say if you are a very good researcher or you have good projects, but if you can't present them, it's less effective because at that point you will not be able to reach out to a lot of people. So let's say when I talk about sign language, I want at least even if it is not, let's say, a perfect implementation, I would at least want people to get interested. To actually get to know that there's a problem in the community with the deaf and mute people. So at least they will be aware. But if somebody is not presenting their work, they cannot do that. So doing all of that is important. Presentation skills and community work, because that's how you interact with other people. I actually happen to know a lot of good folks who in machine learning and data science. Just because I went to a different conferences, I found out their work. That helped me improve my work because, of course, if somebody else is doing very well, you would also want to compete with them. You would also want your work to stand out and, be on par with them. At the same time, because this community is really helpful, a lot of my colleagues from different machine learning fields, they gave me some good advice of how I could improve my work, and I did the same for them. So it is really important.
Really close connections with the community can, you never know how it can really help you out. Maybe it helps you land a good job, a good opportunity. Maybe it really helps you with a few personal projects and stuff like that. The next question I have for you is, what do you think is a bare minimum technical skill set that one can acquire in order to, make their place in the industry or at least to get started?
I think for getting started, I will definitely recommend you to have good problem-solving skills, and that means that not just machine learning, but just problem-solving in general. So, having that mindset is very helpful. And the second thing is being consistent. So even you might not be very very intelligent, that's still okay. But you have to be consistent. You should be hardworking because that's going to show the intent. In terms of technical requirements, definitely having a good hold on one of the programming languages is definitely a very good thing. And of course, mathematics is also is recommended, I'll say. And apart from that, having basic understanding of machine learning is also a plus point. So I know, so all these big companies like FAANG, they don't really if you interview for a machine learning role, they will not ask you questions on machine learning. They will ask you questions on all these basic aspects like mathematics, computer science basics, algorithms basics, basics of machine learning. So they will not go into a lot of detail. So having your basics correct and having your basic concepts right is will help you go in a long way.
True, true, true. Were there any competitive coding platforms you used to practice coding on, or any data science platforms where you used to practice hackathons, different problem statements? So if you would recommend a few, it would be great.
I think you have great coding platforms. You have Leafcode, which I try to do regularly. You also have HackerRank, which is a great platform. So yeah, I mean, this is going to just get you started with the basics of computer science. And for machine learning, you don't have a lot of competitive coding for machine learning, but you have hackathons organized by, let's say, Analytics Vidya, which is pretty good. You have some courses by NPTEL, which is also pretty good. So, you know, the main thing is you should just get started with anything. So it's going to
true,
be
true. Yeah. Another question I have for you, Akshay, is that, you know, where do you think is AI research really going, and how it is going to look like 5 years down the line? What do you think?
So that is a very interesting question, because this field is evolving at such a high pace that
true.
Any you know, prediction might be wrong, might find it correct. But having said that, there are a couple of aspirations, as you know, as a researcher myself, that I would want this field to get into. So so this is only I'm talking about India, because I feel that India has a lot of good potential for applied machine learning. So before doing that, I also have a couple of other friends who are commenting on the feed. So I have my friends from my school, which were friends with me since class second. We have Raghav Mathur, Ankit Jaggi, Chirag, and Archit, and all of my, these are my very close friends back in school. We have been friends for like more than 15, 16 years. So I just want to say hi to them. So coming
nice.
Back to, to your question about the research part. So definitely for Indian audience, I believe that there are two fields where I would want the research to get into. That is healthcare and agriculture. So because India, around 80% of the people are directly or indirectly affected by agriculture. At the same time, healthcare is something that India is, India has lagged behind with respect to other countries, but things are definitely improving. So if we do research, if research happens in these two areas, I think it's going to help or benefit a maximum number of people. And a
true.
Lot of research is already being going on by Google AI Lab, which was set up in Bangalore last year. So they are doing research in both in agriculture and healthcare. We have other big colleges in India who are doing constant research. So if anybody wants to get into research, I think these two areas are definitely going to be a turning point for India in the next 10 years or so.
True. In terms of AI, I think explainability is something we are definitely heading towards. Something which can be interpretable AI, and another one is reasoning systems. So that's why I personally feel there's a lot of work going on. Apart from that, there's deep fake detection and so many other areas where there's so much amount of research going on. And we also have a couple of unsolved problems in AI where there's just a lot of scope for people that are super interested in the field to explore and really find an opportunity to make their career and their name. The last few questions I have for you, Akshay, is that if there's anyone from the audience that wants to reach out to you post the session, how and where is it that they can find you out and interact with you?
So for reaching out to me, you have a link to my website, akshaybagal.com, where you can go, and if you scroll to the bottom, you will see a contact us or contact me page. You have my GitHub account, you also have my Gmail account. So you can reach out to me on Gmail. You can reach out to me on GitHub as well. You can reach out to me on my website. So it also has a chat section. So I look at all these chats whenever I have the time, and I try to reply back to them. At the same time, you can even reach out to me on LinkedIn. You can send me a request, or you can, comment on any of my posts. So I'm going to be really, or you can even just ping me on Instagram. That's also fine. I don't really use Instagram much, but I will definitely try to reply back to all your messages or queries as soon as possible.
Yeah. So there have been a couple of people in the comment section that are asking for your number. Okay. I think these are your friends.
Yeah, I think so. I think, I don't really use my phone much, so even if you have my number, I'm probably not going to pick up a lot of your calls. And after this session, I'm going to be not picking up my calls of even my friends because I think they are also having a lot of fun in the comment section. So yeah, but definitely reach out to me on Instagram. Just ping me. I will be more than happy to reply.
Yeah. Yeah. So they've pretty much been encouraging us to be smiling throughout the session. Apart from that, what is the last message you would like to give our audience today?
The last message is for the students or for somebody who's trying to get into this field or maybe just having a tough time. I'll say that, you know, all of us are together in this. And this is, this time is going to define how this generation is going to be because this is, I think, one of the toughest times for us. So just hold on to, you know, whatever you're doing, keep doing that. Keep on doing your work. And eventually when things get back to normal, you don't even know how things will look like. So it's going to be really great once things go back to normal. Just keep being consistent. Make sure that you put in the effort. And at the same time, you should enjoy life. Have fun, go out when it's allowed. Have fun and just, you know, enjoy your life.
Sounds good. Thank you for joining me today, Akshay, and it was a privilege to have you and to hear from you, your insights, your advices. I'm very sure a lot of people are going to get connected to you post the session. For everybody that has been following this live, if you could go up on LinkedIn, share all that you learned today and tag Akshay as well as me. I can get back to you guys, and I'm very sure you'll also find out a way to interact with him. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining me. That was all for today.
Thank you so much. This was great. Thank everyone for joining, especially my friends for making this fun for me. So if you have any questions, because I saw a lot of questions in the feed, we might not be able to take them right now, but you can always ping me on Instagram or on my, be more than happy to reach out to each and every one of you.
Yeah. Goodbye.
All right. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye.